Let's talk a little bit more about the Lord. Brother Ross has told us the Apostle Paul preached and taught about the unknown God and revealed the one true God to them. And we know he's been revealed in flesh as the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to talk a little bit more about who Jesus is and what he's come to do for us. In past lessons, we've talked about his identity, and we're talking about his work and specifically the death of Jesus Christ. What is the significance of his death? Let me summarize, because we've been talking about the doctrine of the atonement, but let me summarize. The death of Jesus Christ has this effect on our lives. It makes all the benefits of salvation available to the believer. Some are in the present, some are in the future. You see, when Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden, they broke fellowship with God. Everything they had in the Garden of Eden, in that state of innocence, in that state of communion, fellowship with him, they lost. And ever since then, the human race has missed what God originally planned. But through the death of Jesus Christ, he has paid the price for our sins and restored us to fellowship with God, and ultimately going to bring us even further than Adam and Eve ever attained, because we will enter into eternal spiritual life. But we can say this, that salvation covers the whole person, body, soul, and spirit. All the benefits, just think of how Adam and Eve lived in the Garden of Eden and how they didn't worry about sickness or death. They didn't worry about temptation or trials. They didn't have to deal with sin. Well, salvation is designed to compensate or reverse all the effects of sin in our lives and the human race. Now, we haven't received everything. Some things are here and now, but some things are yet to come. There one day we'll be resurrected. We'll receive a glorified body. So not all the benefits of salvation are in the present, but they begin in the present. And what we can say is that the death of Jesus Christ reversed all the consequences, physically, spiritually, and even eternally, all the consequences of sin. So let's break it down. First of all, there is healing. When Jesus died, he paid the price for our healing. Isaiah chapter 53, verses 4 through 5. And I'm using the New King James. It says, "Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." So he paid the price for all of our sin, which enables us to receive healing from God. And I think that word healing here is a broad term, meaning physically, emotionally, spiritually. There is physical healing, but there's also emotional healing, because in the course of life, our own sins or the sins of others can bring lots of damage and lots of wounds. Sometimes someone may just appear to be happy and fine, but you never know what's gone on in their past, that they're carrying some deep sorrow, some deep wounds, abuse, rejection, suffering, betrayal. And these can affect the human spirit. But the good news is there is healing, because Jesus bore our griefs. He carried our sorrows. So you can't change the fact that something happened to you, but you don't have to be weighed down by grief and sorrow, discouragement and despair. You don't have to live that way. Jesus took it for you so that you can be healed. Praise God. And of course, spiritual healing involves the forgiveness of sins. But notice 1 Peter chapter 2 applies this very scripture to our salvation, who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. So Peter quoted from Isaiah, and notice he puts it in the past tense, by whose stripes you were healed. So I think we go to God in prayer and say, "Lord, the stripes were placed on your back when you were beaten. And then when you were nailed to the cross, you paid the price. So when you're playing, it's already done. I'm just claiming the benefits that you've already paid for. By your stripes, Lord, we claim our healing. We have been healed. Praise God. Now, I want you to notice some people say, well, this is only talking about spiritual healing, but I think it's both physical and spiritual. Because in Matthew chapter 8, verse 16 through 17, during the life of Jesus on this occasion, people came to him. They heard he was in town and say that they brought people with all kinds of sickness. They brought people who were demon possessed and he healed them all. He cast out demons. He also healed the sick. So there was both a physical victory and a spiritual victory. And then notice how Matthew describes it, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet saying, he himself took our infirmities and bore our sicknesses. And so Matthew says this is a fulfillment of the prophecy of Isaiah. The physical healing, the deliverance from demons, that is part of what Jesus paid for on Calvary. So don't limit it to the spiritual or don't limit it to the physical. It covers the whole person. We sometimes artificially divide people, ourselves, into physical and spiritual beings. But actually, we're one whole being with physical and spiritual components. And if you doubt that, if you're physically tired, that can affect you spiritually, can't it? If you're exhausted, you can get depressed and discouraged spiritually. On the other hand, when you're blessed spiritually, that can affect you physically. I was reading a study recently, and it talks about how there's a connection between the way we think and our physical health and strength. And they did a study of people as they grew older, Brother Shaw, and it said that people that felt like they were old, this is just payback time. I remember that party they had for me a few years ago. But anyway, people that think they're old actually suffer more from physical ailments than people who don't. And so people who felt, and they did interviews and they felt old, they had more complaints about old age than people who didn't feel like they were old. So there is an interaction if you feel that way. Another study, they divided up some people and they told a random group of women how beautiful they were. And they found these women tended to act more, in a more excited and, they tend to live up to the expectation of them. They've done similar studies of people in school that they told them you've just scored, you know, the top 10% on some test or whatever. And those kids tended to do better in school. And they told the teachers, you've got a group of extraordinary students in this class. And they were just chosen from at randomly, and the teachers treated them differently and they did better. So people's expectations do affect what goes on physically. And so we don't have to divide it up. But when the Lord comes to heal us or deliver us, it can touch us physically, mentally, spiritually, all at the same time. And we need to believe that. Amen. There is healing for us. Mark 16:18, one of the signs of believers is they will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. We ought to expect God's healing power. One of the characteristics of a spirit-filled church is there will be accounts of healing. That when people come, we pray for them, God touches them, they're healed and delivered. Some are instantaneous, some are in the process of time. Some may involve that person doing what they're able to do, or maybe even medical science doing what it can do. That's not incompatible with God's touch. But we believe that God is answering prayer. Amen. We understand that God is sovereign, His will is accomplished, and so some things we don't always understand, or we may not receive instantaneous healing, but we do expect as a normal occurrence in the church that we will have testimonies of healing, of deliverance, of protection, of miraculous works by the power of God. Amen. Praise God. That's because Jesus died for us. Now you might say, well, how come everyone isn't healed instantaneously? Well, remember, some of the benefits are present and some are future. And whatever we don't receive now, we will receive in the resurrection. Amen. Not all healing is going to come in this life. Some healing is going to come on resurrection morning, but it will come. Notice James 5, 14 through 15. This is instruction and promise to the church. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. I remember going to a meeting of the Society for Pentecostal Studies. It was a scholarly meeting. And there was a man there who was from a Pentecostal type of church, a spirit-filled type of organization. And he was giving a paper on divine healing. And he said, well, God can heal. But then he went through this long discussion of all the reasons why God might not heal. And he ended up saying, well, we know God could heal if he wants to, but normally we would not expect him to be healed. Well, in that audience, there was a minister of another denomination, Baptist, and he stood up and he says, I'm curious, you're Pentecostal, you believe in healing. That's one of the tenets of the Pentecostal faith. He says, now I'm a Baptist. I believe in the power of God. I believe God can heal because God can do anything. But ordinarily, we would not expect God to heal. As Baptists, we don't really expect that there will be a miraculous intervention typically. And so he says, now how does my view differ from your view? It sounds like we're talking about the same thing. And this Pentecostal theologian, he was a professor at a college. He basically said, well, you're right. We're about the same. Well, I was asked to give a response to this as a oneness Pentecostal apostolic. And I said, well, I have to differ. I do recognize God is sovereign, so we can't manipulate him. I recognize that sometimes God heals, sometimes he doesn't. Sometimes he heals instantaneously. Sometimes it's through a process of time. There's some healing we don't receive until the resurrection. Nevertheless, what makes me different from what the two of you have described is I believe we're commanded to pray for healing. In the normal course of things, we do expect healing. If it doesn't happen, our faith is not shattered because God's in control. But we pray with the expectation that God will heal. How he does it, when he does it, his timing, his way, that's up to him. But we pray for healing and we expect to receive healing. And I said, the reason why is James 5, 14 through 15. These are my instructions. I'm not just to simply say, okay, I'm going to live by faith. If God wants to heal me, he can. No, I am to pray specifically for healing and then trust God. Amen. And that's the pattern for the New Testament church today. It's sort of ironic that this evolved throughout church history into something the opposite. And that is, in the early church, they would anoint with oil being a symbol of the Holy Spirit, showing that the work is not of humans, but of God. They would lay hands on the sick. That's a sign of authority and transfer of blessing. And these symbols of laying hands and anointing with oil are good motivators for faith because they help you have something tangible where at that moment you can believe that God is touching you. It's not strictly required that the hands touch you. It's not strictly required that oil be present. God can heal with or without these things. But these are symbols of faith. There's marks of obedience, and they help you focus faith for a specific time. And they call on the name of the Lord. Again, recognizing the power is not of us, but it's specifically because of Jesus. Because Jesus died for our sins, that's why we expect healing. Physically and spiritually. So we call on the name of Jesus. So we do these things with the expectation that God will hear our prayer. He will answer. He will intervene. He will raise the person up. Amen. So that's the pattern that we use. But in the course of church history, as people lost the power of the Spirit on a regular basis, what began to happen, somebody would get sick. They would call the priest over, he would anoint them with oil, and they would die, and they would have a burial. And so it actually came into last rites, that just before you die, make sure you get anointed. But it wasn't meant to be just before you die, make sure you get anointed. It was meant to be if you're dying, call for the anointing. And if it's God's will and time, he'll raise you up. Praise God. And that should still be our expectation even today. Amen. All right. So the fullness comes in the future. 1 Corinthians 15:26, the last enemy that will be destroyed is death. So until then, we are going to face sickness. And they say, you know, our cells in our body are dying as we speak. I think, what is it, starting in your 20s, you start losing brain cells. And you have less and less every decade that you go. But those brain cells have more power. So fewer cells get more work done. You have a little experience. So but the last enemy, you're still going to die of something sooner or later. And that's not going to be defeated until the very end. So some things are yet to come. One of these days, 1 Corinthians 15:51-55. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. There will be some still alive when the Lord comes back for the church. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised incorruptible. So if you've already died in the faith, you'll be raised into an incorruptible body. And those who are alive, Paul was expecting the Lord could come back in his day. And so as long as he was alive, he would speak with that expectation. He said, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption. This mortal must put on immortality. And then he says, the end, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, that's the place of the dead. Where is your victory? So in the end, we win. Amen. That's because Jesus died for us. Spiritually speaking, we have forgiveness from the sins of the past. We have power to deal with sin in the present and in the future. Satan is defeated. As far as the child of God is concerned, the devil is already a defeated foe. And in the end of time, his defeat will be manifested to all. Colossians 2:15, it talks about when Jesus was crucified on the cross. Here's what happened. Having disarmed principalities and power, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. And here the Apostle Paul deliberately uses terms that speak of the Roman triumph. When a Roman general would win a victory over his enemies, they would have a parade in the city of Rome, and he would parade some of the prisoners and their possessions, their weapons and the spoils of war that they had captured, and even the enemy general. He would parade them with chains around their neck, dragging them through the streets. He would publicly humiliate them and have the general fall on the ground, and that the Roman general would put his feet on the head of the enemy general. And all the crowd would see that this fearsome general that made them shake in their boots, that he was a defeated foe. And so that was called the triumphal procession. It was the triumph. Well, what Paul is saying, when Jesus died on the cross, and then when he rose from the dead, what he did is he won such a convincing victory over the devil that the spirit world could see the devil is a defeated foe. Jesus put his foot on the head of the devil and said, I won. You couldn't hold me. You couldn't keep me. I broke out of your dominion and I'm alive forevermore. I've won the permanent, ultimate victory. Praise God. It reminds us of Genesis 3:15, where the prophecy went forth that the seed of the woman would fight against the devil, spoken of as the serpent, and that the devil would bruise the heel of the Messiah, but the Messiah would bruise his head. And so that's what Jesus did. He stomped on the devil's head before the whole world. And you know, the way you kill a snake is not by cutting off its tail. You've got to cut off its head. You've got to crush its head. That's the only way. And so what we need to understand as Christians, the devil is a defeated foe. He cannot do anything against the child of God. He can tempt, he can attack, he can oppress, and if we allow him to, then he can push us around. He can bully us. But if we stand up against him and say, I plead the blood of Jesus Christ. In other words, Satan, Jesus already defeated you at Calvary. You couldn't keep him in the grave then. You can't keep him in the grave now. And I identify with Jesus, so you can't keep me in the grave either. You couldn't keep him in prison. You can't keep me in prison. You can't control me. You can't dominate me. I'm a child of God. Praise God. Because Jesus died for us. Hebrews 2:14. I think I used this several weeks ago. But because the children have partaken of flesh and blood, Jesus took the same. In other words, he won the victory on our territory. He didn't just come in as the Almighty God in spirit form, but he came in flesh. He lived our kind of life. He went through all the experiences that we go through, temptation and even death itself. And he won on our terms. So that shows that the devil doesn't have power over us. He himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. The devil's greatest power was death. In other words, if the devil could get you to sin, then the wages of sin is death. So he could condemn you to death. But Jesus forgave us of our sins. That broke the devil's power. He can't kill you anymore, so to speak. He cannot condemn you to death because he does not have the power to force you to sin. Therefore, he does not have the power to put you under the sentence of death. So Jesus robbed the devil of his greatest weapon. When Jesus died for our sins, he took our place. Amen. So James says, resist the devil. And he will flee from you. A positive promise. You go to God in prayer. You rebuke the devil in Jesus' name. He cannot continue to torment your mind. He cannot continue to dominate your thoughts. He cannot keep you under habits of sin. You resist him. And he has to flee from you. We can cast out demons. If someone is demon-possessed or somehow influenced by evil spirits, notice, in my name, they will cast out demons. We don't do it in our ability, but in the name of Jesus. We can say, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Amen. There's no spiritual force that can stand against the name of Jesus. In Luke 10, you have this story. This is even before the day of Pentecost, but Jesus sent out 70 disciples to preach and preparing the way for the kingdom of God, and they came back rejoicing. Even the demons are subject to us. We had authority over demon spirits. And he said, in essence, that's not surprising. I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I was there when I kicked him out. I know all about it. And he says, behold, I give you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Here he seems to be using scorpions and serpents in a symbolic way of evil spirits and demonic forces. So if you ever get in a situation where you feel like you're battling the forces of evil, then I want you to know the Lord has promised, I've given you power to crush those snakes and scorpions under your feet, and nothing will hurt you. Don't ever feel that the devil can get you into a corner and bully you around or physically torment you or emotionally torment you. Do not worry about people putting a curse on you or a hex on you. There are real spiritual forces, but you are a child of God. If you have repented of your sins, if you're baptized in Jesus' name, if you're filled with the Holy Ghost, if you're walking with the Lord, absolutely do not fear. Now, if you're not living for God, that's another story. I remember, and it could happen again, but I remember when I was a child when we'd pray for someone that seemed to be demon-possessed, and they'd be struggling, and people would be rebuking the evil spirits, and somebody would get up and say, now, any of you that don't have the Holy Ghost, you need to leave right now because we're getting ready to cast out the devil. The implication is he's going to find someplace else to go, and if your heart's not right with God, he might pick you. So, but if you are a child of God, You don't have to fear these things. Don't live in fear of some curse or some hex or some, you know, people talk about they feel like they have curses in their lives. Don't accept that. It's only effective to the extent that you accept that. But if you say, I am a child of God, I'm covered by the blood of Jesus, I will trample on serpents and scorpions, and nothing can hurt me. But now, this is not some egotistical spiritual trip where you throw your weight around saying, I'm bigger than the devil. Because Jesus said, nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. So you rejoice because you're saved, because you're the child of God. Amen. So we have power over the devil because of Jesus Christ. We can overcome the world, and that means the world system, the culture, the values, the temptations. Sometimes, have you ever had the experience, you just seem like you're overwhelmed. Maybe by bad news. There's been a lot of bad news lately, not just politics and economics, but the way the culture is going, you know, where it seems like sin is promoted. You notice that? It seems like sin is glorified. And every once in a while you think, wow, this is just a horrible place to be. You know, everything that's wrong is being promoted, and everything that's right is being ridiculed. You just feel overwhelmed. Those are the times you say, even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. You know, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to get out of here. But I want you to realize when the devil presses you or the world presses you, realize you are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who's in the world. So when you see it seems like you're overwhelmed by the spirit of this age, remember, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Don't be intimidated. Don't allow persecution or ridicule or social pressure or ostracism cause you to have a defeatist mentality. Even though you're just one puny human, the Spirit of God in you is more powerful than all the forces on your job or at school or in downtown Austin or wherever you may be. What's pushing in you is greater than the things pushing on you. And so you can push back. Praise God. You can overcome. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith, because of Jesus Christ. Interestingly, not only does the cross give us victory, but ultimately the death of Jesus Christ is designed to deliver the whole creation from the curse of sin. Romans 8, 19 through 23. For the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. What it's saying is the whole creation has been put under the curse of sin. You think about in Genesis 3, when Adam and Eve sinned, God put a curse upon them. Adam, you're going to have to toil and work for a living, and there will be thorns and thistles and so forth. Well, think about that. The very creation was altered. The very ground was altered. In other words, the beautiful Garden of Eden was transformed into a wilderness, so to speak. So even creation is out of kilter. Now, I don't know the full scope of that. But we think of nature so much as destructive. Volcanoes, tornadoes, hurricanes. It's almost as if it's out of whack. Earthquakes. You know, they're called by the insurance agents acts of God. It's kind of strange to think acts of God as if God is killing people using these mechanisms. But what we do see, God created nature and it's running its course. But it seems like instead of running harmoniously, somehow it's running destructively. Everything is out of balance. And notice that God has subjected the whole creation to the curse of sin because he has a higher plan for the human race Notice, because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pangs together until now. And so I kind of imagine these tornadoes and earthquakes and volcanoes, the whole creation is groaning. Something's not right. Something stirring. It's waiting for Jesus Christ to come back to earth and set everything in order. But until that happens, it's under the curse of sin. And then even we ourselves, although we are filled with the Spirit, we are groaning, waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. So we also struggle with pain, with sickness, with sorrow, with death. Even though we're children of God, we haven't received the ultimate deliverance from the curse of sin. We're still working with this human body and with this fallen world with all the troubles and turmoils. And that's why we don't have perfect healing. We're not in the new age yet. We're not in the new world yet. We're still in this old world of sin. So we are going to face physical struggles. We are groaning ourselves, waiting for the redemption of our own body. So all of that is going to be set right. Because notice in Colossians 1:20, by him to reconcile all things to himself. By him, whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of the cross. So there's this idea that somehow the Lord is going to reconcile all things, set everything right. In fact, the last book of the Bible, Revelation 22 and verse 3, it tells us this. Well, let's see. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it. Notice, in the new heaven and the new earth, when God renovates this present universe and transforms it after the last judgment, it says there will be no more curse. The curse of sin will be removed from planet earth, and everything will be restored in harmony. I don't know exactly how it all take place, but even the animal kingdom will be transformed. The Bible speaks of the lion laying down with the lamb. It speaks of the child picking up a snake and not being hurt. In other words, everything that's destructive in this present world will somehow be transformed in the new kingdom of God, so that the very curse caused by sin will be removed. So the ultimate consequences are not just for us personally, but the whole universe. I look at it this way. In the present age, we have the fullness of God's plans for us spiritually. In other words, we receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. That we're restored spiritually. But physically, it's still a work in process. And as far as the external world is concerned, it's still under the curse of sin. But in the millennial kingdom, when Jesus Christ rules and reigns on earth, he will restore everything to harmony in the world around us. And we who will be raptured will have glorified bodies. So what we're going to see in the future is not only the restoration spiritually for us personally, but we'll see the restoration physically, and that restoration extended throughout the whole world and throughout the universe. So it will be the completion of God's plan of redemption for the human race and even for planet Earth. It's really exciting to see what God has prepared. And we only can imagine what eternity will reveal. Once God sets everything right, then he can fulfill his original purpose for creation, which we can only dimly perceive right now. But it will be glorious. In other words, we're just now getting back to where Adam and Eve were. But then God's going to move us further. And where we're going to go in his plan, only God can say. But it's going to be glorious. All of this happens because Jesus died for our sins. So ultimately, we'll have eternal life with a glorified body. Now, exactly what all that would consist of, we don't know. But we know it's going to be eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. We know Philippians 3:21, he's going to transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body. So think of Jesus after he rose from the dead. He was recognizable to people. He could eat. He could drink. He could walk, he could carry on a conversation, but he could appear and disappear at will. He could walk through locked doors. So he was able to participate in what we regard as a full human experience, but he was not limited to a physical existence and spirit. Can you imagine how glorious that will be? That seems incredible, but you know, if you study science, our bodies, which seem so solid, are composed of atoms, and those atoms are composed of protons and electrons and neutrons, and most of what's in between the atoms is empty space, and most of what's inside the atom between the proton and the electron is empty space. So most of our bodies are empty space. It just happens to be arranged in a structure that makes it solid. But God could just flip the arrangement a little bit, and the empty space in my hand could go through the empty space in this desk, and there I'd be past it. You know, so if you just rearrange the physics a little bit, all these things could happen. It's beyond our ability, but not beyond the Creator's ability. So we'll have a physical existence, but we'll not be confined or limited to physical existence. Won't that be amazing? If you could just do whatever you want to do without the limitations of your body, that'd be pretty awesome, wouldn't it? So that's what's going to happen in some way in the future. We'll be like Jesus Christ, 1 John 3:2. Beloved, now are we the children of God. It has not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. That is truly going to be an amazing and glorious experience. Let me just summarize by saying the cross reverses all the consequences of sin, enables us to fulfill God's original intention for the human race. And so the death of Jesus is something we need to be thankful for. He died to give us new life. Let's stand together. Amen. I'm thankful for what Jesus Christ has done for us. We're not quite finished talking about the work of Jesus. We're going to talk about his burial, his resurrection, his ascension, because there are many benefits associated with his burial, resurrection, ascension, but it's all based on the fact that Jesus came in the flesh. He underwent the same experiences that we did, and he died for us. By an innocent human dying, he paid the price on our behalf to set us free from sin and death and open the door to eternal life. Let's give God thanks for his wonderful work of salvation on our behalf. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. So my message tonight is don't accept the limitations that the devil puts on you. Don't accept the limitations that the world puts on you. Don't accept the limitations that your own flesh puts on you. But claim the promises of God and move forward with a positive assurance that God has a plan for your life. You can overcome every sin. You can overcome every chain, every form of bondage, every form of limitation, every negative thought, every evil thought. You can break through it. You can overcome it by the power of Jesus Christ. The blood of Jesus Christ covers all sin. The blood of Jesus Christ delivers from all affliction, all sickness, all disease, all oppression. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. And so if you need the touch of God tonight, why don't you come? We'll be glad to pray with you. If you need healing for your body, come. We'll lay hands and we'll anoint you with oil. If you need to seek God in any way, repentance of sin, receiving the Holy Ghost, why don't you come right now? As we bring this service to a close, when you're ready to be dismissed, you can be dismissed. If you'd like to come and pray, please do that right now. I know there's choir practice in a few minutes. Let's just put into practice what we've talked about, not only tonight, but this weekend. Let's depend upon the death of Jesus Christ as the answer to the needs that we have. May God bless you.